Bhagavan is revealing his vibhutis to Arjuna, and he is pointing out to the best and the most glorious and most marvelous among various units or aspects of this entire cosmos, from the world of devatas, from the world of the adityas, from the wind, from the nakshatras, from the Vedas, from the senses. Among all of them, the best among them is pointed out as Bhagavan's vibhuti. It is that because of which everything functions. So Bhagavan is the very dharma, the very essence of all beings, of all units. He is that because of which everything exists and everything is possible. So this vibhutis are given so that we can use them as a object of our worship, for our contemplation, and to tune our mind to that divinity. So this is like an upasana. So upasana help us to make our mind more and more pure and tune to that divinity. So upasana is one of the most important and interesting sadhana which is mentioned in our scriptures. Just as we do puja nowadays, so we invoke the blessings of, or we invoke the presence of Devi Saraswati, for example, in the murti. So today is Vasant Panchami. So we invoke the presence of the Devi in the murti, and then we offer flowers, we offer fruits, and we do the aarti and we do the puja, so that we are tuned to the divinity who is there everywhere, but we invoke it in that particular murti. Similarly, here Bhagavan is pointing out how we should look at him in and through this entire world. See, in the ninth chapter, Bhagavan had said that everything, a realized person sees me everywhere and he sees everything in me. So, in this tenth chapter, Bhagavan points out that how one can see God in everything. And in the 11th chapter, we will see, Bhagavan will point out how we can see everything in God. So, one in all, and all in one. And one is that Supreme Paramatma. So Ashwattha Sarva Vrikshanam, Bhagavan said, I am Ashwattha Vriksha among all the trees. I am Devarshi Narad among all the Devarshis. I am the Gandharva Chitra Rathah among all the Gandharvas. And I am Kapilo Munihi among all the Siddhas, the accomplished, the enlightened. I am Kapilo Munihi. More vibhutis. Now we'll chant verse number 27. Uchai shravasam ashvanam viddhi mam amrutodbhavam airavatam gajendranam naranancha naradhipam uchai shravasam ashvanam Vidhi mam amrutodbhavam. There is a beautiful story in the Puranas, including Bhagavad Puran, the story of Samudra Manthan. That there is the Kshirasagar, ocean of milk. And once upon a time, the devatas and asuras, they churned this milky ocean and they brought out a lot of wealth from this ocean. And ultimately, they could bring out amrut from this ocean. This is a very interesting story and very symbolic also. Our own antakarana is like that milky ocean. It has got lots and lots of wealth within. Each one of us is very wealthy. So if I say it loudly, people might follow you. But everyone is wealthy. Every one of us, we have tremendous, infinite wealth in our own bosom, in our own heart. Wealth of all the great values are there within us. Our heart, our antakarana, which is shining with the light of consciousness, is like the vast milky ocean. Yeah. And in this ocean of our heart, not only the wealth means the positive good things exist, but even poison is there in our heart. So once upon a time, the devatas and the asuras, they decided to churn this milky ocean. They wanted the amrut. So they came together. Otherwise, these devatas and asuras, they always fight. But this is a beautiful story. We can learn a lot of management tricks also from this story. So they came together and they decided to churn this ocean. Then they wanted that So they got the parvat to act like a mathani. That one. And they then requested, they wanted a rope also. So they requested Lord Shiva to offer his that snake, Vasuki. So Vasuki became the rope, and that mountain became that churning rod. And Bhagwan took Kashyapa avatar of a tortoise, so that the mountain doesn't sink inside. It remains at a higher level because it started sinking. So immediately Bhagwan took Kashyapa avatar, and he protected the mountain from sinking below. And both the asuras and the devatas started churning. The devatas, they held on to the tail of that Vasuki, and the asuras, they held on the mouth of that Vasuki and churned. In between, the Vasuki used to pour out lot of poison also, and the asuras, they had lot of trouble. But anyway, so they started churning. And as they churned, even Bhagwan, Vishnu Bhagwan helped them. He took Mahan Avatar and he started helping on both the side to churn. So as they were churning, great wealth started coming out from this milky ocean. Even Lakshmi came from this milky ocean. A horse came, an elephant came, and so many others actually things came. Then in between halahal, that poison came, and it was so poisonous that even a drop, if it had fallen down, the whole prithvi would have got destroyed. So when it came, they did not know what to do, and they requested Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva had not taken part in this churning and all. He was just sitting, meditating. But they came to him and they said, please help us. So Bhagavan Shiva is Shankara, Shankaroti iti. He thinks of everyone's welfare. So he thought that now this poison, we can't throw it anywhere. It cannot be destroyed. So the only thing I can do is to drink that poison. So he started drinking that poison. And Parvatiji, when she saw that Shiva Bhagavan is drinking poison, she held on his neck so that the poison doesn't go into his heart. So the poison remained in Bhagavan's neck only. So he became Neelakantha. Neelakantha Bhagavan ki jai. So Neelakantha. It didn't go into his head, it didn't go into his heart. See, when we churn our own heart, a lot of negativities also comes. Anger, hatred, especially when people sit for meditation, some past sorrows, pain, trouble, they come up. Unresolved issues, they come at that time. Otherwise, you are very fine. But when we are meditating, all those unresolved things start coming up, surfacing. So we should be able to digest those things. We should be able to resolve them and digest them in such a way that it doesn't go to our head and it should not go to our heart. Poison, when it goes to our head, can make us cynical. And it goes to our heart, it can make us bitter. So poisonous, negative experiences of this world should neither make us cynical nor should make us bitter. They should make us better only. So Bhagavan Shiva showed us through his this leela that he kept this poison in his neck, throat, and it became his abhushan. It's a sign of his compassion towards all beings. So as they were churning, finally the Amrut also came. And then both the Asuras and the Devatas, they wanted this Amrut. And there was a big fight. Then finally the Devatas only got this Amrut. And Asuras did not get. Only the Rahu, Ketu, they got little bit. So they are still there, and they were noticed by the Lord Sun and the Moon. I am telling you story in fast forward to this. So Sun and Moon noticed Rahu Ketu, and this head was cut. And therefore on Surya Grahan, Chandra Grahan, it is as though the Rahu is swallowing Chandrama and Surya. So very interesting stories are there, and many of these stories are symbolic. They are mystic, as our Pujya Gurudev calls them, mystic symbolism. Because there are certain things which cannot be understood abstract unless we put it into words or put it into some picture, it becomes easier to comprehend. So, a lot of symbolism is there in these stories. So, as they were churning, the horse came, and the Asuras, because both of them were doing the churning, so Asur, they said that we want this horse. So, the horse was given to them. This horse is called that Uchchaishravasa. So, Uchchaishravasa is a horse which came and is the most powerful, white, wonderful horse. It came from this Samudra Manthan. Then after some time, an elephant came, white elephant, most wonderful elephant came. And this was taken by the devatas, Airavat. Airavat was taken by the devatas. So these stories are there that within, from our own heart, the fast moving horse also is there within us. The powerful elephant is also, means this, all these qualities are there within us. Sometimes these qualities are taken by the asuras to do their own work. Even the negativities which we have, they also require certain power, certain qualities to work. Even in the society we find, even so-called bad people, they need good qualities to keep their thing going. Even for them, if they want workers and all, they want honest workers. And some of these things are so very, they're within there, they are so honest, like, so very methodical, so very perfect in all, every dealing. I don't want to go into details about it, but it is there. So their organization also works because of honesty, because of sincerity, because of dedication. There are people who are ready to sacrifice their lives. When we have to do something good, people will hesitate to sacrifice their life. But there are people who are joining a negative organization, ready to sacrifice their life, ready to sacrifice the comfort. So sacrificing life and comfort and all, this is a quality which is considered to be very divine. But these qualities are dedicated in the service of asuras. That makes it bad. Qualities by themselves, you cannot say good or bad. Who are they dedicated to? Friendship, for example. Friendship by itself, you cannot say it is good or bad. If one is having friendship towards asuras, then that friendship is a bad quality. And that is what happened with Karna. Karna had great friendship, but his friendship was with Duryodhana. Therefore, Bhagavan Krishna himself told Arjuna to kill that Karna. So if our goodness is dedicated towards adharma, suppose I say, oh, I am such a nice person, very honest, very truthful, and I am serving this antisocial person very sincerely, then I also become adharmic only. So that has to be understood. So here some of these great qualities and wealth which came from this Samudra Manthan, some were taken by the asuras and some were taken by the devatas. So asuras represent the negative and the devatas represent the positive. So Uchchaishravasa, a mighty, powerful horse which has got the capacity to run and sustain and lot of stamina and all, was taken by the asuras. Sometimes you find the asuras, they have great stamina. They have great sustaining power. Go on and on and on. Goodness, after some time, it gets tired. Sometimes suddenly people get excited, cleaning drive and all, they clean Yamuna, clean this, clean that and all excitement is there. After some time they are all tired. But kachra phekne wale, they never get tired. They continue with their journey non-stop, full with full stamina. They don't get tired. So that is the, they have that ashva. Uchchaishravasa, uspe baith ke, ghode pe baith ke, apna kaam karte hai, first class. Aur achche log hathi pe baith ke, apna aista aista ekdom. So, Gajendra, Airavat. So, Airavat is the elephant which came from the Samudra Manthan. So, all that came from the Samudra Manthan is very precious, very good. So, among all the elephants, Bhagavan says, I am Airavat, and among all the horses, I am this Uchchashravasa. And Naranam cha Naradhipam, and among all human beings, Bhagavan says, you consider the king as my vibhuti. Now it's very important. See, the king has got this power to, control, and also to give reward, and also to give punishment. This power is there with Bhagavan, but Bhagavan has given this power to the king also. King also has got the power to reward and punish. But the king should be good, dharmic, should understand that I represent God on earth. So I should behave in the most proper way. In our good old days, when kings used to be there, there were many great good kings, and they were worshipped by the subjects like God only. Like Bhagavan Ramchandra ji and so many other kings, they used to sacrifice their life, they used to sacrifice their comfort for the welfare of their subjects, because they consider it their duty, they consider it their seva dharma to take care of their subjects. In Tulsi Ramayana, Tulsidas ji gives a very beautiful guidance to the kings. When Ramchandra ji had gone to the forest, Bharat ji came to meet him. And Ramchandra ji gives him advice how to rule the country, how to rule the kingdom. A very beautiful advice is given. He says, Mukhaya mukso chahiye khana pana sab ek. Palai poshahi sakala anga tulasi sahit vivek. Ki mukhya jo hai, mukh ke saman hona chahiye. The head or the king should be like the mouth. King should be like the mouth? Yes. What the mouth does? It keeps on eating. So king should be, the mouth eats all that that is required for the body. It comes through the mouth. We eat it, we chew it, and many of the things are digested or is made easy for digestion because of the saliva and all. And then the food goes inside, and the essence of the food is distributed to each and every part of the body according to the need of the body. Palai poshahi sakal anga tulasi sahita vivek. Vivek sahit, with understanding, with discrimination, the food goes to every part of the body. Sometimes there is some pain, sometimes some part of the body needs some more food, so that is given to it. Some brain and all requires more energy, so that is given to it. So, depending on the need of every anga, that is supplied. Similarly, a king is one who takes the taxes from all the subjects and then distribute it for the welfare of everyone properly, using his power of discrimination. See, when food is eaten, if some food remains in our mouth, then it can spoil our mouth. If it remains in between our teeth and all, it can spoil the teeth. It is harmful. So whatever food comes, it is put, it should go inside. Similarly, whatever wealth comes, if some king holds on to it in this country or puts it in some bank in other country, then it is harmful for that king and harmful for the entire society. It is not considered good. So it has to be used for the welfare of every subject, for everyone, according to their need. If this is followed sincerely, then every country will progress in a proper way. Our selfishness and lack of proper understanding makes governance very bad. So if things are governed properly, everyone will be happy. Everyone can enjoy. So Bhagavan says, I considered the king or the ruler as my vibhuti only. Naranam naradhipam. There is a question about Varuna Devata. So among all those creatures who live in water, I am Varuna, the king of water body. Varuno yadasam aham. Then pitrinam aryama chascha asmi. I am among pitris, among the ancestors, among pitara. See, when a person dies, he goes to one possibility that they go to the pitru lok. So there is one pitru lok where all these pitars, they go. And when we do shraddha and all, they get the benefit from it. So the fathers, forefathers and all who have gone, and their children, their grandchildren and all, they do shraddha karma, so that is it as though goes to that particular being, that particular jiva. So this pitru lok is there, and the one who in charge of this pitru lok is Aryama, the devata Aryama, and Bhagavan says, I am that Aryama. Some people may say that, we are doing shraddha, but we don't know dadaji kahan gaye hai. क्योंकि यहाँ पर भी एक जगह जाते थे और कहते थे एक जगह जाना है दूसरे जगह प्रकट हो जाते थे. सो वी डोंट नो वेर ही इज गॉन. इफ यू डू श्राद्ध कर्म एंड इफ यू ऑफर ऑल दिस गुडीज एंड ऑल दिस ब्राह्मणास विल ओनली टेक, दादाजी माइट नॉट गेट इट. बट श्राद्ध मीन्स दैट विच वी शुड डू विथ श्रद्धा, एंड इफ यू डू इट, इट बेनिफिट्स दैट जीवा वेर एवर दैट जीवा इज. If he is not there, then somewhere else, then it will go to that jiva. And other than the jiva, the one who does this karma, it benefits that person also. So, pitrunam, pitrinam, aryama cha asmi, I am aryama. Then, yamas sanyamatam aham, and among the governors, among those who rule, among those who control, Bhagavan says there are a lot of controllers also here. Also in the world we find everywhere there are people who checking and all. If you go to even travel, actually the 10 times they will check and all. As soon as you go, you have to stand like this only. So they will check. There are controllers. We, even after all these controls, still some gadbad can take place. So among all the controller and those who discipline people, who is the greatest disciplinarian? Bhagavan says, Yamraj. Yamraj is the greatest controller, I tell you. Nobody can argue with him. Nobody can give him a bribe. And nobody can escape him. He is the ultimate controller. When nothing works, that thing works actually. Yamraj ji makes everything work. Nobody can escape Yamraj. He is the greatest controller. But Yamraj doesn't mean that he is someone bad and all. Yama is also a great teacher of Vedanta. In Kathopanishad, it is Yamaraj who teaches Nachiketa. So Yamraj is the teacher of this Upanishad, Vedanta, of Brahma Vidya. And he is also very strict, and everything has to happen according to proper discipline. Yama also, that word Yama also means the five values which we have to follow in life, which is mentioned in our Veda, in the Patanjali Yoga Sutra. What is that? Ahimsa, Satyam, Asteya, Brahmacharya, and Aparigraha. These five are called Yama. Ahimsa, non-violence. Ahimsa, Satyam, truthfulness. Asteya, non-stealing. Brahmacharya, self-control. And aparigraha, non-hoarding or non-possession. Too many things one should not possess. These five, if we follow in our life, that is the greatest of all the discipline. So among all disciplines, I am these five. One can say like that. Or among all the disciplinarians, I am Yamraj. I am Yama Bhagwan. So Yamas Sanyamatam Aham. Further. Pralladaschasmi daityanam kalakalayatamaham mrigananca mrigendroham vainateyascha pakshinam Prahladaschasmi daityanam kalakalayatamah mriganam cha mrigendroham vainateyascha pakshina. Among all the daitya, daityas are the sons of Diti. See, these devatas and these asuras, daitya, both of them are children of the great Rishi Kashyapa. So I had told you the story. Kashyapa had these two wives, Diti and Aditi. So Aditi gave birth to all the Adityas. They are the devatas. Aditi. Aditi gave birth to the Adityas and Diti gave birth to Daityas. So there are great, many daityas were there. You must have heard about Hiranyakashyapu, very famous daitya. He had many followers on Twitter. So this Hiranyakashyapu, he had a son who was a great devotee of Bhagwan. He was born devotee, though his father was totally materialistic. Hiranyakashyapu, Kashyap means a shawl like. He was wearing a golden shawl. Means his whole life was like wearing only gold, materialistic. But his son was born a great devotee. Because when this Prahlad was in his mother's womb, that his mother had the occasion to have satsang with Naradji. So this was the first case of prenatal education and all. So she had great satsang with Naradji, and she stayed in the ashram there, and all this samskar reached Prahlad, and he was born as Bhagwan's devotee. He was sent to schools to study about daitya, about all this materialism and all, but still he could only think about God. His father asked him that, what did you learn in school? He said, I learned that the most important thing is to worship God. Shravanam, kirtanam, vishnu, smaranam, padasevanam, archanam, vandanam, dasyam, sakhyam, atmanivedanam. That we should worship God, we should listen to his stories, we should sing his glories, we should remember him, and we should surrender to him, we should become his friend. That only I learned. So his father got very annoyed. He tried to kill him, but he could not kill him. And finally Bhagwan took avatar as Narsingha, and he destroyed that asura, Hiranyakashyapu. So this Prahlad was a great devotee. Then he became the king, and he was very just and dharmic king. So Bhagwan says that he is my vibhuti only. So Prahladaschasmi daityanam. So even if a person is born in a negative environment, one can become great. We can utilize it to rise towards the supreme state of enlightenment. Even Vibhishan, staying in Lanka, he remained Bhagavan's devotee. Then kalak kalayatam aham, among those who count kalana, kalana means counting, like kalayatam, to count, among those who keep track of numbers and counting and accountants and all. Bhagavan says, I am kala, I am time. Time is the one which keeps account of everything very precisely. Whether you are awake or you are sleeping, whether we are busy or we are lazy, the time keeps on keeping track. It never stops. Time and tide waits for none. It continues non-stop. Your watch may stop, but time doesn't stop. Someone may try to stop the watch in order to stop the time, but that is foolish. Time never stops. It keeps counting. Minute, seconds, days, years, month, everything is counted. Dinayaminyam sayam pratah shishir vasantav punarayatah kala kredati gachati ayuhu tadapi namunchati ashavayuhu. Shankaracharya ji says in Bhajagovindam that dinayaminyam sayam pratah, the day comes, the night comes, the evening, morning, different seasons come, and the time keeps moving. Time plays with us, and our ayu also goes. But alas, people don't realize this and they don't go on the right path. The time just passes by. So time, among all those who count, the time itself is a great counter. It counts. Tak, 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 tak. Kala kalayatamaham. Mriganam cha mrigendroham. And among mriga, mriga means all those animals who walk on four legs. Mriganam aham mrigendraha. Mrigendra is a sinh or vyaghra, lion, or even tiger is called mrigendra. And the tiger and lion, they have their own personality. When you see a tiger moving in the forest, it has got its own personality. Many people go to Corbett Park to see tiger. They keep on waiting, looking. Call aa jayega, tiger ko dekhenge. Sometimes they don't see it. Tiger is also hiding behind and waiting for them to go. Once they go, then he comes out. So it has got its own personality. Tiger is such a mighty animal, and unfortunately we are human beings are so bad, they are trying to destroy them. Only few tigers are remaining on earth. It will be so sad that if no tigers are there, and we will have to just watch them on Discovery Channel only, or in children's book, T for Tiger and L for Lion. That will be very sad. So among all the animals, I am that lion or a tiger. And even Parvati, who is the Devi of Shakti, power, she took this lion or tiger as her vehicle. Because she represents power, strength. So the vehicle also should be strong. So mriganam cha mrigendroham. So when we meditate, we can meditate on a tiger as Bhagavan's vibhuti. So there are people who have different images of tiger, lion in their homes and all, but it should be seen as Bhagavan's vibhuti, and one can meditate on that. Just as a lion is there for the entire the forest, similarly, Bhagavan is the one who controls the entire cosmos, the entire world. So whole world is like all the animals, and Bhagavan is like the tiger. That is how we should look. All the world is like Daitya, and Bhagavan is like Prahlad. Then all the world, if you take it as birds, then Bhagavan is Vainateya. Vainateya is Garud. Garud Pakshi, the eagle. which is Bhagwan's Vahan. Vishnu Bhagwan sits on this Garud and he moves. Garud also means our words. The words which we utter, it also is also indicated by the term Garud. So Bhagwan as though sits on words and move. When we go to approach a teacher, he puts Bhagwan in our heart. The teacher in his heart, God is there residing, he is experiencing, and he wants to convey that divinity to us. So kisi pe baith ke jana chahiye Bhagwan ko. So he uses his words. So Bhagwan, Guru's words, Bhagwan sits on those words and enter the ears of the disciple and enter the heart. So Garud is like words, or Garud is that Garud Pakshi on which Bhagwan sits and moves, and he is a fast moving bird, very glorious and great phenomena in the sky. All other birds are tiny little in front of this Garud. It moves with full speed. So vainateyascha pakshinam, among all the birds, you meditate on me as Garud. Further, he says, pavana pavatam asmi ramashastra bhritamaham jhashanam makarashchasmi shrotasamasmi janhavi pavana pavatamasmi ramashastra bhritamaham. Pavanaha pavatamasmi, among all those who purify, among the purifiers, Bhagwan says, I am Pavana, the wind, the air, the wind. I am Pavana. Because it is the greatest purifier. Even if a room also is closed and the air gets trapped, it becomes like poisonous only. When you open the doors, windows, and the air moves, it purifies the entire room. Even in our body, it constantly purifies us, it gives us life, it gives us health, and makes our body also pure, mind also pure, this pavana, which constantly moves. And it is a great sevak also. Without making any noise, without making its presence felt, without any show and glamour, it keeps serving all beings. So therefore, the greatest devotee and the greatest sevak of Bhagwan is also Pavanaputra, Hanumanji. And here he has silently come. Before Ramchandraji, Hanumanji comes silently as Pavana. His father has come, so the son will not be very far. So Hanumanji has also silently appeared before his master comes. The sevak comes to prepare the ground. So Pavana pavatam asmi, I am the air, which is the among all the purifiers, I am this pure air, which human beings and other creatures breathe, and which also purifies the nature, the surrounding. Ramashastra bhritam aham, and among all those who wield weapons, I am Ram, Shri Ram. See, weapons, everyone do not have the capacity to hold these weapons. Weapons they are like double-edged sword-like. If it is not handled properly, it can destroy the person who is holding it. It's very dangerous. And in our scriptures, in our tradition, we find that devatas, who are pure in their heart, they are holding this weapon in their hand. weapon is held to destroy the evil and to protect the good. That is the use of that weapon. Paritranaya sadhunam vinasha.